Hey everybody, what's new? It's 6 o'clock. It is Wednesday, January 13th. Kind of a slow news day, not. I'm gonna have a conversation with Anthony Scaramucci. Anthony Scaramucci, AKA The Mooch, who was part of President Trump's inner circle. And we thought it would be really interesting to hear his thoughts on what's been happening today. For those of you who aren't aware, Donald Trump has been impeached for a second time. Of course, the big question is whether or not he's going to be convicted. And I'm trying to see if Anthony Scaramucci is joining me yet. Anyway, to give you guys a quick latest update, he was impeached again. 10 Republicans voted with the Democrats. It's going to be sent to the Senate, but Mitch McConnell has already said that they're not going to take it up until after the inauguration. I'm having some scotch. Please feel free to join me. I'm now a scotch drinker officially. The pandemic and everything else has sent me to drink a little bit, but not that much. Anyway, let me just see if I can see the request. Hey, team KCM, the Mooch. If you guys see Anthony coming in here, would you guys let me know? Because I'm trying to find it. Hey, Jonathan Adler, is that the Jonathan Adler I know? Let's see, I'm just gonna look for him. And see if a hi, Brian Atwood. Hi, Josie. Josie, where are you, Carolyn Mano? What do you mean you're unable to join? I've got a lot of good friends. I typed his names in the comments, not the search. Okay. All right. Let me do this again. I didn't mean to do that. Scaramucci. Let's see. I did it, but I'm not seeing it. Oh, wait, I do. I just saw it. Here he is. Is that a request? He's unable to join. Oh, no. Hey, Josie. Anyway, hope everybody's doing well. It's been a very crazy day. I got CNN on one eye and you all on the other. Anyway, doesn't look like the Senate's going to be entertaining this, as I mentioned. Hold on, let's see if I can do this again. I'm gonna try one more time. I'm doing it, here we go. I just did that, and let's send another request. Anyway, Anthony Scaramucci is quite a character. He went to Tufts, and then he went to Harvard Law School. Hi, hey.
Oh, hey, Katie, turn the phone away, right? I'm sorry, I'm new to this.
That's all right.
Nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Thanks so much for joining us, because I thought you'd be a really fascinating person to talk to, Anthony, because you were part of President Trump's inner circle. You served as the director of communications at the White House for a whopping 10 days before
it was 11, Katie. Don't chip me out of that last day. It was a big day. That was the day of firing. That's when the axe came down. You can't chip me out of that last day.
Okay, sorry. Let me clarify that. For 11 days, obviously, this has been a huge week news-wise. A lot of stuff is going on. You know, I think you would probably know almost better than anyone. By the way, we should mention that you were a very vocal campaigner against Donald Trump in 2020. You went and endorsed Joe Biden. You traveled all over the country, and I know you worked very hard to do everything you could to ensure that President Trump wasn't reelected. You know this guy well. How long have you known him, by the way?
Well, you know, probably like, you know, people that worked at NBC, you may or may not remember this. I was a CNBC contributor for many years, and I had met Mr. Trump through the NBC ecosystem. And so basically I'd gone to many parties with him, apprentice parties, finale parties, that sort of thing. But when I really got to know him in 2012, when we were working on the Romney campaign together, we hosted several fundraisers in his home that triplex apartment. I don't know if you've ever been in there. It looks like Louis the 14th smoked crystal meth and then decorated the apartment. I don't know if you remember.
Yeah, but intense, I know.
Intense. And so we did a couple of fundraisers there. You know, listen, I want to be fair to him. He was a gregarious host. He had a charm about him back then. And when he ran for president, I frankly didn't take it seriously. I was with Jeb Bush. I don't know if you would remember that, but I was working on Jeb's campaign with Ambassador Woody Johnson and Jack Oliver and members of the old Bush team. And when Mr. Trump slayed all of these people, he called me and he asked me to come in and help him. And I thought I was doing a loyal thing for the Republican Party. And you know, in our society, we have two choices for the presidency. The right choice, frankly, in 2016 was Secretary Clinton, but I was a Republican. And I went with I went with then candidate Trump around the country. I learned a lot about the country, Katie. You know, the country that you've experienced, obviously, through your broadcast journalism career. And there was some great sadness for me seeing certain parts of the country where, you know, I grew up in a blue collar neighborhood. Parents didn't go to college, but we were an aspirational blue collar family. And we've seen over 30 or 40 years the conversion into desperational blue-collar people. And I got to see that firsthand on the campaign. And I'll tell you, I was very sad about that. And so when Mr. Trump was speaking in those areas, I said, okay, these are forgotten men and women. He's providing a voice of advocacy for them. And of course, I got that narrative wrong. He got into the presidency and, you know, started doing things inside the presidency that were damaging to those people, frankly, damaging to our standing in the world, damaging to our allies, and then trying to be a loyal person to him. And I think this is the loyalty trap that many of his supporters are in right now. You know, about 2 years ago, I said I could no longer support this. And I tried to explain why, you know, and also apologize for my support of him, try to own the support. And frankly, Katie, to create an off-ramp, there are 74 million Americans that have voted for President Trump. Some of them are now radicalized and acting like domestic terrorists, but some of them are normal people. They just, you know, they see a culture war in the U.S. I frankly don't see that war, but it's a narrative in the cable news networks and the talk radio networks. And we need to diffuse that. We need to create this off-ramp for those people. And so I've been working very hard on that over the last 6 months.
So, Nancy Pelosi just said, today we learned no one is above the law in the United States. You know, 10 Republicans sided with the Democrats, as you know, today with the article of impeachment. It's going to be sent to the Senate, but not until Joe Biden is elected, even though Mitch McConnell reportedly said he supported this impeachment, which I think came as a surprise to a lot of people. You know, there slowly some of the support is starting to peel away, but many Republicans are still so adamantly supporting President Trump. And I'm wondering if you talked to any of them, if you can explain the psychology and why they refuse to. I mean, as my husband just said to me, if this is not impeachable, what is? And how can you say, oh, he only has 9 or 10 days left and he's going to behave? But, you know, shouldn't there be a statement made by people that certain behaviors are simply unacceptable and inciting violence in the heart of democracy in the nation's capital, at the Capitol building, trying to hunt down Speaker Pelosi to do who knows what? You know, if that's not impeachable, what is? And why are these Republicans refusing? And why do they continue to insist, despite everything to the contrary, that the election was rigged?
Well, there's a lot there. So let me break it down. I would say the first thing on the impeachment and where the Republicans are, it's very sad for me because I was a lifelong Republican. And I would say to you, as you and I were growing up in this country, if there were differences in ideology, no one thought that Jimmy Carter was going to call for an insurrection any more than they thought that George Bush Sr. was going to call for an insurrection. We had differences and we tried to resolve our differences. And there was some partisan rancor, of course, but there wasn't this level of extremists. And so what's happened, unfortunately, we've lost that civic connective tissue. Perhaps there's less people serving in the military or less people connecting with each other. And we've become way more tribal. And these people are now, through great cynicism, they're thinking about their own personal power politics and their own ambition. And so they're saying to themselves, okay, well, I want my job. I want to be in this Congress next year. President Trump has an overwhelming draw of power in that party, whether we like it or not, we have to accept that. As an example, this morning's polling came out. He's at 40% to win the nomination. He's double Vice President Pence, as an example, who's at 18. And so these people are looking at it purely political, purely profiles and cowardice. They're siding with him to avoid being primaried or running the risk of angering his base. So that's level one. I think it's a disaster, actually. And, you know, John Kennedy once said, Katie, he wrote three books. One of them was Profiles in Courage. And David Brinkley said to him, well, that was a pretty thin book. And Kennedy quipped, well, there was no courage out there. I was doing my best to find courage. And we see Mitt Romney having that courage, or Liz Cheney, or there were 10 people this afternoon that voted against the president. But no, we don't have the courage. And then the secondary thing that you're talking about, I think, is equally scary to me, that we're leaving so many people behind, and we're creating an environment now of have and have nots, and we're creating an environment of dug in cynicism. And we have to break that fever. And if we don't break that fever, Katie, unfortunately, it's going to get worse for us. Whether you like President Trump listening in on us or not, he has hurt our standing globally. And whether you like him or not, calling for an insurrection, and by the way, they were chanting a death to Speaker Pelosi and death to Vice President Pence. And of course, the president's reaction to that was very muted. So I find the whole thing to be very un-American.
I just want to mention that, yes, he seemed to have absolutely zero remorse yesterday and was not contrite at all, said he found there was nothing wrong with his statements. Now, he just released a video, and my team is kind of transcribing it as we're talking, Anthony, saying, I want to be very clear. I unequivocally condemn the violence we saw last week. Mob violence goes against everything I believe in and everything our movement stands for. No supporter of mine could ever endorse political violence. I have to say those words seem slightly specious given the fact that he his rhetoric for the last 4 years has in fact been, I would say, extremely pugnacious at best in terms of urging his supporters to be, you know, he says, you know, kick them out, and talks to police officers and said, don't be too nice. You know, how honest do you think sort of those words are? He didn't mention his second impeachment in the video they released. He condemns what he calls efforts to censor, cancel, and blacklist our fellow citizens are wrong and they are dangerous. It's interesting to me how his supporters have pivoted to the censorship argument, taking him off these platforms like Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, et cetera, and kind of have moved on from the violence of last week. And I don't even know what my question is after all of that. I just wanted to share that with everyone. But, you know, what do you think he's thinking now? Do you believe his words that he condemns the violence, or is he kind of been backed up against a wall?
Well, you know, listen, there's a duopoly to him. You know, obviously when the words are printed for him by the White House counsel or by a speechwriter that's trying to moderate him, he'll sound moderate. But if you really look at in detail everything that he's done over the last 4 years, it's actually violent and it's borderline aggressive. There's very fine people on both sides in Charlottesville. He said that when the looting starts, the shooting starts. He put that up on Twitter. He told the people last week that they needed to get tough and that they needed to be courageous and they needed to put up a fight and take a fight to these people. His personal counsel, Rudy Giuliani, somebody I know a very long period of time, I say this with great sadness about Rudy because I want to remember him at 9/11, Katie, or prior to that as he was trying to help rebuild the city. But now we have the version of 2021 Rudy Giuliani that was calling for combat justice less than an hour before these men, mostly men, frankly, some women, but mostly men, descended on the nation's Capitol building. And they were going up there to perpetrate violence. Obviously, a police officer was beaten to death. And so, no, he has no standing based on the 25,000 lies and based on the pattern of his behavior. you know, he said during the campaign, punch people out and take them out and beat them up. And we've roughed these people up. And that's him. And so it's reprehensible. You know, 2 years ago, I spoke out against it. I said, this is not something that we can have stand in the presidency. I said it was Trump noble back then in July of 2019. And I said, the Republicans will make a choice. They'll either clean this up like they did Chernobyl, or they'll cover it up. And if they cover it up, it'll be a disaster for the country. And of course, they acquitted him and covered it up. He has very bad executive management skills. So we totally mishandled the COVID-19 crisis. We've lost 13 million jobs, Katie, since he arrived in Washington. So he's made the country weaker. He's made the country sicker. He's made the country poorer. And yet, because of the cult-like nature of his personality and this perceived culture war that we're in, we've got a very ardent base of people that are clinging to him. And we have to break that fever. We have to dislodge those people who have these sort of religious cult-like convictions around Mr. Trump. And I think we will do that.
How do you do that, though, Anthony? How?
Well, the number one thing you have to do is you have to provide opportunity. And these people feel left out. And so we need to provide economic opportunity. And I would take your viewers and listeners to speeches that were made by Franklin Roosevelt in 1940. He was running for an unprecedented third term. He was running against Wendell Willkie. He had the specter of the far right with Charles Lindbergh. They were calling themselves American First back then. And there was a specter of white nationalism. And Franklin Roosevelt made a few amazing speeches, but one in particular that you can find on YouTube called for the aspirational opportunity for working class men and women. And, you know, he was trying to set the bedrock of that. Of course, the war interrupted that. But on the back end of the war, with the appropriate policies from Truman and Eisenhower, we got that aspirational liftoff, Katie. And of course, all of that white nationalism, all of that sort of nonsense dialed down. You did get a little scare with McCarthy, another demagogue, but by and large, the country was very happy. You have a happy country where people feel engaged. They don't feel left out of the system. They get less angry, and all of that rancor dies. And so we have to do that. I've talked to members of the vice president, now president-elect's economic team about this. We've got to have long-term planning. The bad news for everybody listening, this is not something we can cure in a day, a week, a presidential term. But we need a 5 and 10 year plan for manufacturing, an industrial policy, right sizing of our K-12 and educational systems. And we need to talk very honestly to the American people about what we need to do to fix the country. And something I would say to everybody is we have to be Americans first. It's not America first. Let's be Americans first. Let's put the country ahead of each other. Let's stop hyphenating ourselves or digging into certain tribes and sort of hating the other tribe and so forth. Let's think of ourselves with that great commonality and that great spirit that we need to have in our culture to advance ourselves. And I'm very optimistic about that, because one thing Mr. Trump did to us is he unified us. He just happened to be unifying us against him. You've got people like me and Rick Wilson, who should definitely get on, or somebody like Steve Schmidt, are now teamed up with Bernie Sanders. Right, exactly. Yeah. You know, we're teamed up with Bernie Sanders and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez to defeat Donald Trump. And so we're Americans first. Let's come together and make the country stronger.
I think that sounds great, but not to rain on your parade. But if in fact he's got a 40% approval rating or 40% likelihood to be the next Republican nominee, as you said, Mike Pence has 18%. If he continues to have a bully pulpit with some conservative network or whatever he does, because we know he's very much addicted to attention. How do you wean people off of that? Even people who like to watch him because they piss him off so much. You know, there's a lot of engagement through enragement. You know, that's why people, you know, and let's face it, the Biden administration is going to probably be a snore compared to the last 4 years, you know, because it's going to be the business of governing isn't a reality show. And so I guess the question is, given that he still has so much popularity, 74 million people, high, you know, likely, you know, still a big favorite among many Republicans, high approval ratings in the Republican Party. You know, how do you draw attention away from him and this politics of anger and resentment to these aspirational values that you think we need to really focus on?
Well, first of all, I'm personally signed up for the boring. I'm looking forward to the boring, Katie. I can't wait for more boring, frankly. I got enough action in my life. I don't need the nonsense from the press.
You're breaking up a little, Anthony. Hold on. Can we hear you? You know what? I'm going to sign off and sign back on, okay? I'm going to sign off and sign back on. We'll be right back and we'll just finish up our conversation.